is Jim Campano, editor of the West Ender newsletter. To my left is Raymond Tupper, publisher, and to my far left is Sonny Lopresti, who's a six-year alderman in Somerville, and 2 years as the governor's council. Mr. Lopresti is also the head of the West End Reunion Committee, and he will speak later on. Now we're what we're here for is the West End is a letter that has been formed by Raymond and I for former West Enders, and we've
We have a mailing list of about 3,200. It's a like a personalized letter, and it's a communication letter for former West Enders, and they use it as such, how to communicate with each other that they haven't seen over a period of 30 years or so. And it's the newsletter, incidentally, is for nothing. And we mail out to people that would like to receive it. We have a mailing address. It's the West Ender, Post Office Box 413, Somerville, Mass. 02144. There's no charge for it, but we do accept donations.
And now, Sonny Lopresti would like to say a few words about the coming reunion.
Right, Jimbo, we're having the reunion again this year for former West Enders at the Wonderland Ballroom on Sunday evening, October 9th. This is the Sunday before Columbus Day, and therefore Monday being a holiday, people have the day off. We'll make it easier for people to attend. Tickets are still $10, as they have been for the past two reunions. We have entertainment. We have a disc jockey who plays both old and more old than new music, I should say, relating to the West Enders, as it's been down 30 years. We have some light hors d'oeuvres. There are several bars. There's dancing. It's a great time, only for $10. And if you'll permit me, I'd like to give the phone numbers.
Sure.
They can call. Anyone interested can call 628-2479 or 289-0956 or 438-2624 for reunion tickets. We expect approximately 1,000 people to be at this reunion this year.
Why don't we see a few of the scenes from last year's reunion?
All right, my name is Sonny Lopresti. This is the second annual West End reunion we're having here at Wonderland Ballroom. I'm going to pass this mic and ask each member of the committee to say their names.
Hi, I'm Maureen Parker.
Hi, Jimmy Parker.
Hi, Stanley Friedman.
Paula Friedman.
Nikki Polcaro.
John Polcaro.
Barbara Lavolo.
Tony Lavolo.
Joseph Miola. Lovey Lavolo.
Marie Carino.
Joel Piccolo.
Jim Campano.
Eleanor Pappas Costinden.
Marion Downey.
William Downey Jr.
Ooh, Denise Salzgiver.
That'll be good.
What's his name?
Raymond Papa.
No, Jay?
Enough for you. Raymond J. Papa.
Gotta get that in there.
Popo Chicho. I don't want to set the world on fire.
Come on, we're gonna get
it. Let's pass it down. Okay, here we go. Pass it down.
Hey. Let's go. Da-da-da-da-da. Feels like heaven being here tonight.
This group here, we all came from one girl came from South and over to the West End, because I introduced her to the West End. And Mary and myself, Elise Lockhart, was Elise Lockhart. And Barbara Rossi, she lives in Dorchester now. She's around still. I hope she comes tonight. But it was a fantastic group of girls. John Kennedy sponsored us. He got us our sweaters, our Ivy League sweaters. Had Ivy's on it. It was a great time. I love the West End.
When you left the West End, you moved to Somerville, and you ran for Alderman, you became a member of the community. Did you find a big difference between Somerville and the West End?
In many respects, I did, and some I didn't. The West End was a closer knit community because we lived closer together. You know, we in my building, I was in a six-family building, and the next building, if you put a hole in the wall, you were in it. Somerville was a little different, a little more spread. However, there were things that resembled the West End. Some of it was a diverse community. They had all nationalities, as we did in the West End. And, you know, they had Greek people, Italian, Lithuanian, Polish, Irish, English, you name it. And they all got along relatively well here, too. And I found it comfortable. I found a lot of West Enders found it comfortable. And I think more West Enders moved to Seminole than any one location because of that.
Mm. Well, you once called the West End a neighborhood in exile in one in the Globe article.
Right.
Could you expound on that a little bit?
Well, I said that because even though we've been out of there 30 years and there's no longer a West End as we knew it, we've kept our bonds. Most West Enders I know are still very closely affiliated with the people that they grew up with. I know the other night I went out to dinner, there were something like 25 of us, all former West Enders. And we do it, we're always in touch with each other. You know, a lot of them are still members of the West End House Alumni Association.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Others, the Peabody House Alumni Association.
Right. That's
why we found it, when we had the reunion, we found it so easy to contact people because everyone had remained close to their friends.
Well, last year you had about 2,000 people at the reunion. Do you think you'll get that many this year?
I don't think we'll get that many this year, only because it was the first time we had it was the year before last,
right.
And many people couldn't come in. And last year we had them plus the repeat people. I kind of think now that that will taper off somewhat, and hopefully so, because last year was just wall to wall.
Yeah.
It was too uncomfortable, really. We didn't have enough seats.
Yeah,
for
it really was.
It was a great time, too.
It was a great time, yeah.
It always is.
It was a nice time. It was.
Do you remember many of the characters in the West End that were there?
I'm just about all. When you talk characters, you mean people like... there were a lot of characters. I think... In their own rights, each person was a character in the West. You know, I think of guys like a friend of mine's father, Billy Downey,
right.
Who everyone knew Billy in the West End.
I think him more as a neighborhood legend. He was sort of a tough guy. Yeah.
Billy was a tough guy, but he was also a very warm guy, if you
right.
know him. I mean, he was a great friend. He was a great friend of ours. Yeah. Stanley Freeman's father, Lester, was a
right.
guy like that. Everywhere you went in the West End, you knew Lester
right.
because he
right.
taught boxing at the West End House. And even though he had around 9 kids of his own, he was at the West End House every night, and he was always there, you know, to help you out.
And Raymond's father was a legend for his people.
Oh,
yeah.
Sure, he used to beat him, rush him down the mat, general, and pump him out immediately.
we used to kid Raymond's father, his name was Charlie, we always said, Charlie, you're making meatballs out of sawdust. But because in those days, all the bars had sawdust on hand, they put them on the floor so
yeah.
to absorb the dampness.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact of the matter is, I think he had the best meatball I ever tasted. He had great meatballs.
Yeah, they were. They, you know, a lot of people commented on it, you know, they used to... You know, you get the old digs, this or that, but they all come back to eat them.
Yeah,
you know, for 25 cents in them days, how can you beat a sandwich this big with 7 meatballs in it?
I know.
And, you know, the bar itself, you walk in and
right.
in the middle, sagged in the middle.
Then you had Chibi Burger a couple
right.
of doors away.
Yeah.
Chibi
right.
and Rosie owned the bar.
Corey.
They were legends themselves.
Yeah, oh, Rosie, who incidentally is still alive, living in, I believe, a home in Roslindale.
Right.
I think so.
Yeah. Jewish rehab in Rosie.
And she's still got all her sense of everything. You know, matter of fact, I spoke with Rosie on the phone a couple of years ago. She called the penalty box and I had spoken with her on the phone. Hi, Raymond, do you remember me? And I was talking
yeah.
to her. She was all excited, yeah. And she gets her newsletter. Excuse me. She insists on receiving a newsletter.
Yeah. Well, the storekeepers in the West End were incredible. And they were at their businesses from early in the morning till late at night.
Oh,
so
yeah.
If you're on the bar, you were there till... At least one in the morning, maybe two cleaning up, and they were there the next morning
it
opened.
Exactly.
I mean, even the variety stores, Mrs. Kramer,
right.
she lived in the back of the store. She was there 7 days a week. They opened around 7 in the morning till 12 midnight.
Well, Jaime's
that
there.
That was their whole life. You know, it's
yeah.
incredible the time they put into it.
Jaime's the same. All the small stores, Joe Flea.
A lot of those mom-and-pop stores became bigger, and like Godfrey's. Godfrey's moved up to Route 1 afterwards and became quite an operation.
How about Stop and Shop?
Stop and Shop.
That was
exactly.
one that started on Chamber Street.
Yeah.
Actually, there were quite a few famous people out of the West End. The Redstones, some of the Redstone and his family were originally. Barry Newman.
Joseph E. Levine was
Joseph
one.
Joseph E. Levine.
Ryan
he reneged on his pledge.
Yeah.
Oh.
The West End House.
Yeah. Lenny Nimoy, Ruth Roman. Yeah, there's quite a few.
Lenny Nimoy, Jerry Colonna.
Right.
Mm. Sure. That's quite a few came out of there.
And Spring Street was quite a diverse street. You could walk down there. That was reminiscent, I guess, of a lot of the places on the east side of New York.
Yeah, Spring Street was like the market.
Right.
It was the market when we were kids. When
oh,
I was real
thing.
Small, there were, you'd see push carts and even wagons, horses and teams. And then in later years, you didn't see that anymore. You know,
mm-hmm.
they just, but the stores always stayed open. On weekends, they're open until 12 midnight, all those stores.
Oh, sure. Right. Yeah. Anytime you needed something, you had it somewhere to go.
There's always something to do now. It was an exciting neighborhood, too.
Yeah, it was exciting.
You know, the thing is, a lot of people who didn't live in the West End have heard about it, too, and I don't know if they can actually visualize what it was. I mean, the West End, to me, was just incredible. You know, you had everything there. The families, everybody was friendship. Your doors were open. I mean, if you got out of line down the street, your mother knew about it before you got home.
Oh, yeah.
You knew the routine there. You got a kick or a slap.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if the local policeman on the beat gave you a kick, you get another one.
Oh, yeah, you got another one.
You could do that in those days. You know, it was
great. Matter of fact, I was telling Sonny earlier, I was stopped at the near the penalty box Saturday morning, and they have a electrical box outside. It was 7 o'clock in the morning. I just stopped there, and I was staring off at the new buildings that are up there, and I could visualize the West End as it was then.
Mm-hmm.
And my mind just wandered, and I could see Wall Street and Eaton Street, Springs, everything, all the kids playing. It's funny how your mind plays tricks on you that way. But it was beautiful, you know. I was just, you know, somebody see me, they would have, this kid's a nut, and I was laughing, you know.
It was different. I think a lot of it was, it was warm because we made it warm. No one had money, but they were poor, but no one told them, actually.
How poor,
you
were
know, you'd go outside, and you were really rich because you'd go outside and you'd play Relivio or Buck-Buck. You'd go roller skating down the street. You'd make things. You'd make your own scooter with an
roller skate. Never went bad.
Yeah,
and
if you recall, when you played ball over there, everyone played. If you played baseball, football, you bucked up, and it wasn't a thing that you had a travel team. Everyone got in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And you hardly ever played baseball, the baseball that wasn't taped. I didn't know baseballs were white. And it was a lot of fun. I mean, there was. I'm sure other urban neighborhoods went through, you know.
I don't know if other urban neighborhoods had, but we had. You know, we had the Western House, the Peabody House, the Christian Science, the Heat Christian Center, the Bullfinch.
Mm-hmm.
And
the Burrows.
The Burrows, yeah. Burrows was the newspaper boys.
Yeah.
But there were so many different places that you had to go to. I mean, the kids, Peabody House, you go to dances. Everybody, you know, the Western House had their parties for kids. Then you had the Salvation Army, which also did an awful lot for, you know, people in the West End.
Yeah, we had still a lot of service clubs in the West End that were good for the kids.
Yes.
And they had a little of everything. If you recall, the West End House, they also had declamation teams. They were very strong on sports.
Yeah.
Peabody House had a chemistry lab. They had a theater there.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't strictly sports. I mean, there was something for everyone at that time. And they just reached out to the whole community. And you think of all the time you spent in these neighborhood clubs. Hadn't you been there, you would have been into some kind of mission.
Oh, no question about it. Sure, no question about it. We had that. Right. That was what was unique about it. You had somewhere to go to stay off the streets.
Oh, yeah.
You stayed out of trouble, right?
Busy. I don't remember kids saying there's nothing to do.
There's always something to do. And you had the ballparks. Yeah, the kids, every schoolyard was handball.
Well, like I say, everyone played. Today, if a kid, I'm against that a lot, if a kid wants to ice skate today, if he can't make the hockey team, his chances of getting a rink to play hockey are slim and none. In those days, we go down to Boston Public Garden or the Commons.
That's all we had.
We'd skate. We'd play hockey. That was it. That was actually play. Everyone got in, you didn't have to trial for the team. It evened up. Those who couldn't play too good just could pick last, that's all.
But everybody did.
I wonder if other states played punch ball. Other cities played punch ball and those type of games.
I don't know about punch.
I know half ball was big in other cities. We used the whole pimple ball with a stick ball. They used the half ball. But naturally, when the ball broke, you cut it in half. We had two balls.
Yeah,
to play.
Nothing
went away. Everything was used and reused.
But you take an old can and discard a can and play kick the can and spend the whole night with that.
It was
amazing. Night after night after night. I don't see that today. I go through neighborhoods and I don't see too much of this. Of course, you didn't have the traffic that you had today. To stay in the street and kick a can today, you'd probably be run over. You know?
Okay, now we're going to move on to a development update. Okay. According to HUD statutes on urban renewal, residents displaced by urban renewal should have priority in the housing built on the land taken for urban renewal. This means West Enders should have had priority at the Blackstone Apartments and at the Amy Lowell. The Lowell Square parcel, which was awarded to Jerome Rappaport by the court, is being appealed by the city, and they think they have a good chance of overturning the ruling. In case you missed the ruling, Judge Robert Hallisey ruled that Charles River Park will be allowed to buy a piece of property worth approximately $8 million for about $100,000 it was worth in 1958. In any event, it should be resolved in the court in the next 6 months or so. Jerome Rappaport of Charles River Park subverted the HUD requirement of priority to victims of urban renewal clearance by imposing an artificial barrier of high rents, higher than lower moderate income residents of the West End could afford. It was a case of de facto class segregation. The Chardon Street parcel, which the state was to have put out a request for proposals, has been held up because the state doesn't have the money and the state doesn't want to give up the parking lot on the site. Now for a few notes from different West End sources. The West End Branch Library will have two special lectures on the old West End of Boston. On Thursday evening, September 29th at 6:45 p.m., the public is invited to take a visual tour through Herbert Gann's West End of the 1950s. Jimmy Campano, editor of the West End Newsletter, will give a slide presentation of about 75 slides made from pictures that Mr. Gans took when he was preparing his book, The Urban Villages. On Thursday, October 20th at 6:45 p.m., Joseph Caruso, writer, painter, and former West Ender, will give his impressions of growing up in Boston's old West End. Admission is free and all are welcome. The library is located at 151 Cambridge Street, Boston. From the Boston Preservation Alliance, there was going to be a religious property tour of the West End and Beacon Hill. Enjoy this rare opportunity to see a hidden part of Boston's architectural heritage on Sunday, October 2nd, 1988, as the Boston Preservation Alliance hosts its second annual tour of Boston's religious sites. This year, 10 religious sites in the old West End and on Beacon Hill will be featured on the self-guided walking tour from 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. Learn more about Boston's diverse history through its great architecture and social institutions in two of Boston's important historic neighborhoods. Tickets are $10 in advance and $12 the day of the tour. Tickets will be available at the bookstore, 76 Chestnut Street, the Architectural Bookshop, 66 Hereford Street, or at BPA offices, 45 School Street. For more information, please call 367-2458. From the West End House, the annual West End House Alumni Association dinner will be held on Monday, October 24th, 1988, at the West End House, 105 Alston Street, Alston. Tickets are $15 each. For further information, call 787-4044. From the Peabody House, tickets are available to alumni members for the barn dance to be held at Camp Gannett on October 1st, 1988. Tickets are $15 per person and $25 per couple. Those wishing to purchase tickets can call any alumni member or Barbara Acaputo at the Elizabeth Peabody House, 623-5510. Anyone wishing to help on that evening can contact Carol Faria at 322-1092, extension 5209. And the Peabody House is planning a West End night on November 20th, 1988 at the Elizabeth Peabody House. Our applications are in for the permits. We are going to need a lot of help that evening. Anyone wishing to help, please contact Richie Pupper at 776-9439. More on this later. That's it for community updates. And now we'll go to some of the old scenes of the old West End. We have a tape made from, a video made from 8mm movies. And we'll run a couple minutes of it.
Okay.
That's the old Joyce Street police station. And that's Chambers Street heading down. Cambridge Street.
From the cup.
Chambers Street looking down towards Charles Street. The old West Church.
Which is still standing.
Which was the library when the West End was up. St. Mary's Polish Church. St. Joseph's Church. And that's McLean Street. That's the old Mayor Schoolyard.
That was school. A big school. That's the top part of Chambers and Poplar.
Chambers, that's the synagogue.
Here's my house.
The original Godfrey's. Lowell Square, as it was.
is he?
No. Hey. Pagano's
gas station.
Gas station.
Look at that cash.
By a police officer, I forgot his name. Next show, yeah, I will give it to you. Well, now back to some of the questions from some more information from Sonny Lopresti. When you moved out here and you became the alderman, you were very involved in the neighborhood. And you became a politician for a lot of years. What was the comparison, you know, when you were an alderman, why did you become an alderman?
Well, I ran in 1969 because I had been around politics all my life, and I saw an opportunity to run. I also saw a lot had to be done in this city at that time. Summer was at a bad, in a bad state of affairs. The schools were deplorable over here. And in 6 years, we built, I think it was four new schools. We renovated another five, built the fire station, redid seven or eight parks. I happened to be in a reform movement. I'm not taking credit for the whole thing.
Right.
But there were, I think there were 9 out of 11 new aldermen, and there was a new mayor at the time. And,
right.
It was a good time. They were good times. They were fun times. And a lot was done. A lot of development was done here.
Well, let's get back to the reunion. It seems like last year we had a lot of fun at the reunion, and we're looking to get more people back there this year. Raymond was one of the coordinators.
I try to be.
Yeah.
Oh, the reunions are great. I mean, if you get an opportunity, this is your opportunity for someone you haven't seen in 30 years to get together. I mean, it's just anybody that doesn't make it, you know, for any reason, shame on you, the way I look at it.
Yeah.
The tickets are still available. And
the tickets are still reasonable.
Yeah, they're pretty reasonable. For $10, you get a whole night of entertainment, and then you get to see people that you haven't seen. There's a lot of love involved. There's crying, tears, happiness. I mean, everything is there you could ask for. And I don't know of any other reunion that could possibly be as good as a West End reunion, because it's people getting together that no longer exist. Their homes have gone, have been taken away, and they get together. It's just great. And like I say, people should attend these things. They're not going to go on forever, because a lot of people are getting older and they're passing on.
Well, we agreed we're going to have the reunions until it comes down to just two people.
Yeah, well, either you or I left. That's it. That's the end
hopefully.
Of it.
No, I think if you lived in the West End at any time, you'll meet someone you knew at the reunion,
right,
because there were so many people there.
Well, seems
and they come from all over the West End. It's not just one neighborhood, you know, one local.
Seems wherever you go, you run into somebody from the West End.
They're everywhere. I've bumped into virtually thousands in this city alone. And you know, they're in Medford, they're in Stoneham, they're North Shore, South Shore. They're all over the country.
They're all over the country, yeah. You said the right words. I mean, they're in Hawaii. Yeah. I go to Florida quite a bit, and now Florida, next door neighbors are from the West End.
Well,
there's people up the street
up
there, and we have quite a few that come up for the reunion. We have people come
Florida,
out of
California.
California, Hawaii, Texas, Vegas. There's quite a few in Texas that come up here, you know, all over the country. Who do we mail for, like 32 states?
Right.
And the Netherlands.
260 people out of state.
And then we mail out of the country.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing that people have heard about the newsletter, that want to receive it, and they're there. And like I said, the opportunity is there to see each other, or mainly to communicate with each other through the West End, if people would take advantage of it. Some people do, some don't, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the main purpose of the West End, you know, as Jimmy and I started it, not to get off the subject of the reunion, but to get back to the West End. And that was the purpose of it, for people to understand, hey, you haven't seen this, we can get addresses for you. Call us, let us know. We'll give you the address just so you start communicating again. And it's worked out pretty good so far.
Yeah. You know, a couple of things I should mention, too, that people don't realize. We've kept that ticket price low. But not only that, the reunion has benefited a lot of people because the funds of the reunion, we donated some money to the West End House for camp scholarships for kids who couldn't afford to go. We brought a dozen beautiful, huge picnic tables for the Elizabeth Peabody House, Camp Gannett and Sharon. We donated some money for some equipment for a newsletter, and certainly you need more for your mailings.
Yeah.
And we gave some money to the St. Joseph's Church.
Mm-hmm.
We recently gave a donation to buy camera equipment to the Boston Public Library, which is doing a history, a film history in the West End. So whatever was left went to all strictly to good causes. There was no money.
Right, all the money's accounted for different ways. It's all it's been donated. Yes, that's the beauty part about it. Yeah. The money's there, and it goes to where it can be used for kids, for other reasons.
I think next year, you know, in my travels, I meet a lot of people who lived in the West End who became more aware of what's going on through the newsletter, realizing that people that they hadn't even seen in many years were neighbors in the same towns, that we should now, all of us, concentrate our efforts to some degree in helping the newsletter, because I'm sure it's very expensive mailing this and putting it together. And I don't understand how you've done this without charging for it. I've been getting it for several years now, and you know, it's a free subscription.
I think I can answer that. We had a pretty good thing going in plain English, whereas the cost was zero. The cost most of the time was donated.
Right.
Matter of fact, all the time was donated. The printing itself was donated. But now, like I say, times have changed. People got big eyes, and you got to be careful of what you're doing, you know, not to make any accusations.
Right.
So we're gonna start changing the format, what's that paper I'm trying to think of? Like the record, tabloid. A tabloid, right, in the form of a tabloid. We'll be able to have photographs, everything, and it'll change. As time goes on, it'll change, but now we've got to pay for it, whereas we didn't pay for it before, and that's why it was easy to run. All we had to do was pay for the mailing. So we do ask people, if you can, please send a donation. It does help. Everything helps.
See, an individual picks up a newsletter, and they'll read it, and they'll say, well, wonderful, you know, what can this cost? A few cents, but how many do you mail out now?
Well, we're getting close to the end of the show. Is there anything else you'd like to say?
Yeah, I asked you how many you mailed out.
Approximately
3,000. Right.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to thank everybody that had anything to do with this, especially the SCAT crew and SCAT. They've been very good to me, especially. It's taught me quite a bit. Except to be on stage or on camera, because I don't think I'm doing too good today. But be that as it may, it'll all work out sometime, I guess. And I'd like to thank Sonny Lopresti for coming here today and spending a little time with us.
Yeah, well, thank you very
good
much.
Good man.
I'd like to thank everybody else that had anything to do with it, the cameraman, and everybody else.
Remind them, incidentally, that we do have a cameraman that's probably from the West
End. Yes. I would like to, Ike, would you come out here, please? Right here, please. Would you stand there? This is Ike Wilburn of the West End, who we found out afterwards that he was a former West Ender. Big hand for Ike.
Hello, Ike. Right on. Better known as Isaac.
You find them everywhere.
They were everywhere.
And so that's about all I can say. And if you'd like to see the West Ender continue, if you're not on the list, send in your name to the West Ender, P.O. Box 413. Somerville, Mass. 02144, and we'll send one out to you. And
we do accept donations.
We do accept donations.
Don't be afraid.
We're pretty tight right now.
We accept pennies. Don't be afraid to send them.
And anybody else that had anything?